Dear colleagues, thank you for the opportunity to perform at this highly representative forum, to present at this fantastic forum. So at the beginning of this session, I have more answers than questions. I have more questions than answers because most of the presentations are highly most of the questions are highly relevant. So new. So we are quite used to the fact that neoadjuvant therapy is one of the effective approaches. So it is our task, it is our goal to defeat the disease at any cost, provided the patient is not the cost. However, pelvic tumors are one of the key problems in oncogynecology. So the patients, many of our patients present at very poor hemoglobin levels. Not every clinic is able to adopt this patient, to take on the patient, and to provide specialized treatment. So the this is the question, how can these patients be helped? My clinic is a multidisciplinary, well-equipped center with broad opportunities for nearly all in nearly all areas of medicine. Invasive cervical cancer can be complicated by hemorrhages in a large proportion of cases, in 60% of the cases. We suggest radiotherapy to patients with large-sized tumors of upwards of 4 centimeters, and it's one of the most weighted approaches, for especially if patients live in areas remote or distant from advanced clinics offering advanced surgical treatment, state-of-the-art surgical treatment. So what do we have regarding pre-op radiotherapy? If the patient stops to bleed, the effect from radiotherapy ensues on day 7, day 10, and then hemoglobin falls. And from what we know, radiotherapy is not quite as effective in patients with low hemoglobin levels. So primary chemoembolization was indicated to patients with uterine body and cervix tumors. And we started accumulating experience giving treatment to these patients since 2015. Our clinic has 4 apparatus for stenting, for radioisotope treatments. We perform about 70 cardiovascular surgeries in our clinic per week, so we did have access to these devices. One of the most frequent findings when you read journals, publications in journals, is that chemoembolization methods are sometimes described indiscriminately. However, they form a highly differentiated field. Let us consider chemoinfusions and hemostatic sponges. A microartery arterial spasm in patients with doxorubicin and cisplatin can ensue in 15 minutes. So 5 hours is not the time that we need anymore. Another thing that compromises this method is this. Look at this. The patient is a heavily bleeding patient. This is a perimetrial vessel entering the vagina. The hemorrhage is quite severe. So, it would be erroneous. It would be wrong to infuse medications for 5 hours and then install and then place a hemostatic sponge. And we're describing this as chemo embolization when in fact it is not. Embolospheres can be infused, but they are also PVC of a certain density that is coated with medication. So it is practically a glazed nut situation that we are talking about. So the glazing may melt. However, the nut may end up in the wrong artery. So these two methods are practically not used at the moment. However, they're quite frequently described in publications. Embolizations with DC beads. A DC bead, again, is a small hollow ball coated with medicine, carrying medicine on the surface. The cytostatic action is minimal. So it would be problematic to describe this as a cytostatic medium. I don't have any commercial interests, but selective chemoembolization with hemispheres. And there are just two cytostatic medications. Moreover, doxorubicin, that can one of the drugs that can be used, must be diluted half an hour before the manipulation. Irinotecan must be diluted at once, immediately prior to the manipulation. These methods require very acute attention to detail. They work. They do work very, very effectively. What are the materials and technologies that you need for chemoembolization? You need to have an. You need to have angiographical equipment. You need to have contrast materials. You need to have manipulators available. Larger manipulators are cheaper. They serve for guiding microcats in iliac arteries. Microcats for selective embolization are more expensive. And if a clinic performs 70 angiosurgical investigations per week, such catheters will always be available to angiosurgeons. And the surgeons immediately evaluate the configuration of the vessel and know what catheters to use. Other than that, it may be a bit expensive because no small clinic will be able to procure catheters to match every size of the vessel. Why did we go for hemispheres when we looked at embolization? Because functionally, lipidol lipitols elevates transaminases a week after the intervention. However, hemispheres do not have this effect.
With hemispheres, the local effect is better. This is this work is not done exactly by us, but in Russia, with the intestine cancer, they demonstrated a very clear-cut treatment metamorphosis with rinitecan in the hemispheres. before the resection. Anterior resections, and the mechanical absorption is like a sponge, actually. The hypospheres have different diameters. We can always select, and they're packaged differently. We can always select the flask that we need, usually for small pelvis. 50, 100 are used, and they cover, I would say, the diameter of 2 millimeters, and they do it quite well. Arteries, of course, I'm talking about arteries. What are the medications to be used? We can see the saturation is quite good. The absorption is very good, so the drug has a local cytostatic effect up to 21 days, so on the average 14 days. The best treatment metamorphosis is on the 9th to 14th day. This is optimal, so when there is a surgery, then better to have it at this period of time. The methods of hemobilization. Now, we can easily set out the tumors, and we selected the vessels for embolization. The catheter is selected, and there must be an MRI before we start working with the patient in order to understand what the stage is. And the microspheres are filled in. Then there is control evaluation of vascularization and the control of petamorphosis. And so here is the length of the tumor before embolization, and that was last week, actually. This patient was hospitalized a month ago, and thus I will be able to demonstrate all the steps and stages. The tumor is in the cervical canal, and you can see that it is even on the body of uterus, and in minus 1.5 centimeters in diameter, you can see the circular diameter and prior to embolization and after. This is an example. Will periatrium with proper chemical embolization disappears? It shrinks. It becomes more solid, and morphologically it has been proven. And that is because the drug embolus are there in place and properly administered. And look at these photos. And here is the here are the lympho nodes, the MRI diffusion, and we can have all the details of the nodes properly seen. They are the affected nodes. I could no. There is also a slide after the surgery, but not a single one of these can be seen. There is just a small hematoma in the small pelvis. And here are the lymphatic nodes. They are damaged, and this is the third stage for this patient. So he was able to get chemoembolization with the rintican, and here is the angiographic image, and here you can see what it looks like. You can see angiogenesis is quite obviously manifested, and here is the microsphere in there, and you can see there is no blood circulation in this part, and here is the tumor distantly, and here is the morphological biopsy prior to embolization. It is mucinous type of this cervical carcinoma. Here is the tumor after embolization, necrosis, and you can see the embolus with the medication with the you can still them. There's, and here is the treatment metamorphosis. And here is the activity and reactivity of the tumor due to the cytostatic effect of high-dose chemotherapy. It's 100 milligram for 6 centimeters of tumor. That's very intensive. And here is another patient, microscopic results of fluorescent microscopy. You can see that the cytostatic accumulates in the cell, and the cell disintegrates. And of course, we would like to look at the VEGF expression, but well, this is probably at the later stage when other institutes join in. We really should look at the capacities we have and what we can do in the future, what we can extract out of this method. And here is a unique patient. I had surgery on her 5 years ago. She's 94 years old. She's 94 years ago now. 5 years ago. ago, she had the cancer of uterus and HP is 68, so there is hemorrhage and it's 6.5 centimeters. Here is the where hemorrhage is, and we can see this infiltration and the MR diffusion after embolization. You can see it. There is calcinate after embolization, and here is prior to embolization and after. Calcinate is there. This is the tumor necrosis. And angiographic picture. Here you can see the angiogenesis and microspheres, and you can see that the blood circulation in this particular area is stopped. The hemostatic goal is achieved to 100% within 1 hour, and right on the tip of the needles, it's also happening. What is the post-embolization syndrome? Quite moderate. Frequent defecation, problems with urination. If we take the upper bladder or the lower bladder artery, particularly with the recurrences, what's most important, and I found it in one of the articles locally, this drug, irinotecan, can work as radio modificator. These women can be immediately sent over to the radiation therapist, and we can start radiotherapy right away. This is what is so good about this method. We have an experience of work with 52 patients, 26 with cervical cancer. What's again, I send this. That's a tumor over 4 centimeters. There are worse results with infiltrate. And, I'll speak about the risk factors a bit later. As for the local recurrences, now there are 17 women who do not have any other alternatives. And as a method, we can reproduce it cytostatically with a cytostatical purpose once in 3 months. So 3 months is the time when the cytostatic works. If there is a systemic chemotherapy administered once in 21 days, then with the local activity of hypospheres, we can actually carry out this particular procedure once in 3 months. This is prognostic factors for different other cancers where we use it in a much more extensive way. So with tumor over 5 centimeters, the nodes, the tumor in the capsule, hypervascularization, and without thrombosis, these are the positive effects. If there is a thrombosis, then the effect is going to be much worse, and practically no effects. There are no effects. There were 2 women who were embolized in other institutions without any drugs, so in order to stop the hemorrhage. And they immediately had the growth of infiltration. Radiation therapy was denied to them because there was a very very serious risk of the damage of fistula, of the appearance of fistula. And today we cannot really we cannot allow that the hemorrhage is stopped using those traditional methods. If there is no clinic, then just send them over to our hands. We can use embolization methods. And in St. Petersburg, there are at least 2 institutes that have the necessary capacities. And I'm sure in Moscow, it's even easier to do that.